starting with the gentleman next to me, I have Adam Warner. And Adam Warner discovered WordPress in 2005. He has been working within the community ever since. He founded several WordPress businesses, including Foo Plugins, a free and premium plugin provider. He's a true WordPress evangelist in spirit and personality. And that also happens to be his job with, want to stand up? Show us what's on your shirt.
Sitelock.com.
And I have Lauren Jeffcoat. Lauren has been building WordPress websites for almost a decade, and she's currently part of the On-the-Go Systems WPML customer support team. She enjoys creating WordPress websites and has worn many hats. Do you have any hats today? No hats today.
I don't have
one. Oh, she doesn't have her hat on. In the world of WordPress development, including project manager, customer service representative, account strategist, and web designer. While she's originally from this area, now she is living in Surfside Beach, South Carolina. Lauren can be found as the organizer of the WordPress meetup Myrtle Beach, and a co-organizer of WordPress Wilmington. She speaks at WordCamps frequently, including this one. Christian Nolan. Christian Nolan is the Vice President of Development at Imagine, a 50-person digital agency that specializes in custom WordPress solutions for B2B companies. At Imagine, Christian oversees the production department and web development initiatives. Before joining Imagine, Christian held positions in technical support, software quality assurance, and web development. Let's welcome our panel. So we discussed the first couple questions that we thought would be most interesting to the group. And the one that I'm going to start with is, what happens to a site? Let's say you are looking for some support, and you might contact a plugin developer or your theme designer. You might go to the support forum on the WordPress.org website. You're having a problem, and the first thing they say to you is, hey, can you deactivate all of your plugins? And you hold your breath. So the question I'm going to pose to our panel is, what happens to your site when you deactivate all or some of your plugins?
I'll start since I'm the supporter, and I use that term so frequently. Oftentimes, as a supporter, when we're asking a question like this, it's because we're trying to isolate the issue. So while we realize it's inconvenient to have to deactivate all plugins, typically, you don't lose all the data that's associated with your plugins. In a normal circumstance, if you deactivate your plugins and then turn it back on, everything kind of resumes itself. But I'll let these guys pitch it too.
So I think one of the things you'll want to do in that situation is not panic. When you start thinking about having to deactivate all the plugins, like you said, you think, you know, that there is going to be this terrible situation where all your site, where all the function on your site is going to go away. You should plan a course of action. Just because someone says that they want to deactivate all the plugins on your site doesn't mean that you need to rush to do it. You can sit back and say, what's the best way for me to test this out? And there are a lot of great hosting solutions out there that offer you staging environments, whether that be something like Pantheon or WP Engine. They all give you that ability to do something in a more, you know, walled garden type of area, so you can deactivate your plugins without causing any more harm to your site that you're currently experiencing.
Both pieces of advice really good. Does anybody not know what a staging site is? Okay, a couple people. So a staging site is basically a copy of your site, an exact copy where you can make changes and do things without affecting your live site. And so the best practice is, if you're asked to troubleshoot your website at all by, in this case, deactivating all the plugins to find out if something's conflicting with something else, is to do it on a staging server. Because then you have no reason to worry at all that you're going to lose any functionality on the front end. And just to add to that, If you're also asked to deactivate your theme or switch to the default theme, some themes have functions built in which affect the functionality of your site. Some theme settings might get lost with widgets and things. I'm not sure how prevalent that is now, but you definitely want to do that on a staging site as well so you can avoid breaking something in worst case scenario.
In regards to the staging site too, if you don't have a staging site on, or your server, or your host doesn't provide that, you can create a copy on your computer too, using on your local development. So you can test it on your local development, and then once everything's okay, publish it live.
Okay, can you come to the, would you mind coming to the microphone so that it'll be picked up in the recording?
Okay.
Let me tell
you. Thank you.
Is a staging site something that a host should offer? Or is that only for agencies and larger sites and organizations?
Good question. I would say any, let me backtrack. It's not something that used to be very popular with or available to end users. It was more something that as a tech-savvy user, you could set up a local website environment with MAMP or some other tool. But hosts have come around to realize that staging sites are so important, end users want them, and they make it easy for people to do, like WP Engine, and who else did you say? And Pantheon, and SiteGround, and other places. So it's basically one click, you make a duplicate of your site, and then you have a separate login area, you can do all kinds of things, you can destroy those staging environments, you can have multiple ones. Does that answer your question?
Okay. I think in general too, I don't know how many people here do hosting through another third-party service like Bluehost or HostGator or something like that, right? So you probably pay not that much for their shared hosting solutions. Those solutions may not offer you a staged environment. So just a general piece of advice I would say is the website, whether if it's promoting your business or promoting you and your career, it's the base that you present to the rest of the world. So protect that investment a bit and consider going beyond your typical, you know, $9.99 a month hosting and look into something that is, you know, more suited to WordPress as a platform.
Sorry, one more thing to add with staging. You can use a local hosting environment, and there are pieces of software that make that a lot easier, so you don't have to get super technical. One is called Desktop Server by a company called ServerPress. They're well ingrained into the community. They do a lot of community support. And then there's also the Duplicator plugin, and then Staging Pilot is one by another guy in the community. So a couple other options if you want to make it easy.
I will add something relating to that. If you're running a backup of your website on a regular basis, even if something does happen, you will at least have something to reach back to if you don't have a staging site. If you need to remove a rogue plugin, or just something that has a small, small glitch, but if you have to just have the capacity to find it. Does anyone have any questions relating to the things that we just talked about, either staging? I know front end was mentioned. Did anyone have a question about what it, what does that mean? All right, we'll have to take another question. This is probably one of my favorites. Is it better to be a plugin minimalist or have a huge plugin party on your website?
I'll speak very briefly. I am a shiny new things guy, so I have been guilty of having literally more than 200 plugins installed and activated on a site. Now, there's this long-going debate about whether the amount of plugins slows down your site and this and that and the quality of the code, but since I've learned my lesson, I now am a minimalist, but I am still a shiny new things guy on my staging environment.
I think that it really greatly depends on the quality of the plugins that you have installed. You can have 80 plugins installed on a site that runs perfectly smoothly, and then you install one bad one, and everything falls apart. So I tend to lean more towards the modest side. If you don't need it, if you don't absolutely need it, then you're probably better off not putting it on your website. If you install plugins and then you end up not using them, don't leave them inactive on your site. Delete those plugins. I'm guilty of having a bunch of inactive plugins on my sites too. But I don't think there's a right or wrong answer for that. I think it really depends on everybody's different website needs.
I think it also, you need to have a plan for everything you do with your website, and I think adding plugins and choosing what plugins you want to use or not use in your site plays a role in that. So going back to this, you know, best practice approach, I think you should benchmark things like performance before you go and add a plugin. So you can use services like GT Metrics or Google PageSpeed, and you can see how is your site performing prior to adding the plugin, and then you add a plugin and see how it has negatively or potentially negatively impacted your site. GT Metrics and Google PageSpeed Insights. And I think in terms of volume, then that doesn't, you know, volume can potentially have no impact. Because it does, to what you guys were talking about, it depends upon what is it doing. Is the plugin adding back-end functionality? Then you might see a performance loss on your back-end, but not the front-end. Is it a whole bunch of, you know, maybe social media engagement stuff that's rendering third-party scripts and adding more CSS and more JavaScript to your site? Then yes, that could possibly negatively impact your site's performance, and adding more of those plugins to your site would probably be something you want to try to avoid.
You have a question?
Why would you need 80 or 200 plugins? And with that many, that amount, how much would it cost?
The answer to that question is you never, probably never, need 200 plugins. It's never a need. But so I've had a long history with the platform. I started by blogging, and then I was creating themes and plugins and things. And again, the shiny new object syndrome that I tend to have is I would like to test the functionality of a plugin. So I would install it, activate it, play around with it. It's not something I want. So I'd move on to the next one. Or I'd test five or six plugins that do the same thing. So that said, and what Christian and Lauren have already said is to, If you're installing plugins to test the functionality, or you're trying to find the functionality for the site that you need, make sure that you do go back, deactivate those, of course, but also delete those so you don't have the extra overhead. The second part of your question was cost. How much does it cost to have 200 plugins installed on your site, or 80 or 5? If you're using plugins that are in the WordPress.org plugin repository, the cost is zero, because it's open source software and everybody is free to use that. Now, if you have some functionality that you need or that your client demands, maybe you'll find that in a premium plugin instead. So there really is no one answer to that question. It all depends on your specific needs. Does that answer your question?
One thing I wanted to point out, Christian raised a good point about running your tests on your site before you activate plugins to see if there's performance difference. If you've activated a bunch of plugins or all of a sudden you see performance issues on your site, Query Monitor is a good plugin to use to see which plugins are taxing your site or causing some lag time with your performance. Yeah, Query Adams asked what Query Monitor shows the results of each of the queries. So each plugin is typically running different queries on your site and hitting your database. Query Monitor will show you a list ordered from which is hitting the most, which is taking up the most time. So does that make sense?
Does everybody know what a query is? Does anybody not know what a query is?
Are you saying, tell us about it.
Yeah.
Okay, so a WordPress is PHP, JavaScript, and then you have a database. A query, it's a MySQL database. A query is what the code outputs in order to retrieve data from the database. So if you have 5 plugins, you install a 6th, and then all of a sudden the speed of your site goes down, you know obviously there's an issue. But if you want to find out what plugin is causing that, there's another plugin you can install called Query Monitor, which monitors all those SQL queries, or basically all those data retrievals from the database, and it will tell you, hey, this one's taking 30 seconds, and it should be taking, you know, a few milliseconds.
I think to add a little bit to your question before about why you would need that many plugins is because WordPress as a system allows you to do a lot, but it also gives you the ability to extend a lot of functionality. And developers in general have this notion of kind of separating concerns. So they'll say, I want this one piece of functionality to behave differently. So they'll make one plugin to change that functionality. So if there are potentially 80 different areas on your site that you want to behave a little bit differently, that's why you may need that many plugins.
So the next question I wanted to bring up is about when you find a plugin that does, we'll say 80% of what you need, but now you've got 20% of what you need to figure out a different solution. So is it common to be able to change code in the plugin without breaking it, or do you need to just totally find a new solution?
I'll start since I'm not the developer up here. I'm not a coder. It is easy to access plugin files if you are capable of, and you're good with code and you want to get in there and make those changes. Easy meaning it's easily accessible. So when you're on the dashboard of your WordPress website, you can go to the plugins page and there's a little drop down, I think it says edit. And you can, when you click edit on a plugin, it actually shows you all of the plugin files. So you have access to all the code. However, if you do mess with any of the code in the plugin files, as soon as you run your update, which you should always be updating your plugins, all of that will be overwritten. So you would have to redo all of the work that you've done. So I guess it really depends on what that 20% is. Is there a premium plugin maybe that you could switch to that could do that for you? That might be a better solution in different situations. Like I said, I'm not a coder. So for me, I would personally probably look for something that can do what I need to do, or hire someone.
So one thing I'd add to it depends a little bit on the plugin author. So you may have a plugin that where the author has put in different points where you can hook into it and change the outcome, or they may give some templating options that you can override. Like WooCommerce is a great example. It has a templating engine that you can put a WooCommerce folder in your theme directory and override the output of the plugin on a template-by-template basis. Other plugins will store data it returns into filters, and a developer could hook into that filter and augment the output. So there are ways you could modify a plugin without affecting the core integrity of it, and that would allow you to continue to get updates without, you know, having a concern of your customizations getting overwritten, and also gives you a more controlled way to kind of tinker with the functionality of the plugin versus modifying core and not really understanding where it is. So as a general rule, just don't modify core anywhere.
And just to add to that, you have 80% of what you need, 20% of the feature functionality you need is missing. The first decision you need to make is, do you get that custom developed by yourself or someone else, you hire it done? Or do you start looking for something else that ticks all your boxes? Shiny object syndrome will never tick all your boxes. So what we're talking about is developing what are called extensions or add-ons for existing plugins to add extra functionality. So some good examples are Gravity Forms, WooCommerce, Caldera Forms, Foo Gallery, and what Christian has said is the plugin author will put things called actions and hooks within the code, which will allow another developer to go in and do something at a certain point that the other plugin does something to add your own core code, functionality, or feature. So my advice would be to look at getting an extension developed, or start looking for extensions for whatever plugin you're using that tick the rest of your boxes. Make sense?
Does anyone want to bring up a question? Or do you want me to just use another one of my questions? Oh, I see a question way back there.
Hi. Am I talking?
She's going to bring you
okay.
The microphone.
Thank you. So I have a local environment that I develop in, and I have a production environment that I deploy to. When I need to test or work with a new plugin, locally I have to install it, get whatever version, and then as it works right now, I have to deploy my code and then go to production and install that same plugin. So my problem is that there's a potential for different versions. It's not an identical environment. So I'm wondering if there's a way to, on deployment, say, this is the version of this plugin that I want, and have it installed kind of in an automated fashion versus having to manually go in. Is that possible? And if so, is there a recommendation?
So you're talking about you've tested out a plugin in some sort of environment outside of your normal site, your production site. And now it's maybe weeks or days later, and there may be some differences between the two environments. So what is the solution to doing that? Is that
sure,
your question?
Yeah. Sure.
So that can work with your hosting platform. So for example, WP Engine has the notion of a staging environment, and it's also through the dashboard of one click. So you would say, I want to take my production environment and send it to staging. And that would take a snapshot of everything you have going on and put it into your staging environment. You do and test everything there, and when you're ready to deploy, you could say deploy to production, and it will move everything over for you. It will do all the search and replace, it will bring over the plugins, and Pantheon has similar functionality. So that type of tooling is where you can find, that type of tooling in places like premium hosting platforms. There are other plugins out there that can similarly do some of that work, but if you want a more automated fashion of doing it, I would look into just a more managed WordPress hosting solution.
Okay, thank you.
Does anybody else have a question? Or should, oh,
way in the back, way in the back.
Can you bring back the microphone? Oh, thank you. I have an assistant. People in the back are the ones with the questions. We should just leave the microphone back here.
So, other than the basic description, searching for a plugin, what kind of criteria do you guys go through, like downloads or comments, talk to the decisions?
It sounds like a question kind of relating to what was next on my list was how to determine or how to have a good situation when you pick a plugin that's not going to break your site. Does that sound kind of like you?
Okay, so I'm sure Lauren and Christian will help me out if I forget any of this, but when I am looking for a plugin to offer some feature or functionality, typically I'm looking in the plugin search within WP Admin, which pulls from the .org repository, or I'm there directly. And some of the indicators for me on whether or not a plugin is good, good is a relative term, is some indicators are when was the plugin last updated? And you can see that information when you look at a plugin description. Everything I'm going to talk about, you can see when you pull up a plugin. When was the plugin last updated? How many, I'm kind of going in reverse, how many active installs it has. If a plugin has 200 active installs and it's been in the repository for over a year, it's probably not a very quality plugin, or Maybe people just don't have that need. If a plugin has 100,000 or 1 million active installs, you can bet that it's pretty solid. Also look at the star rating. There's a 1 to 5 star rating on every plugin. When it was last updated, I said, and you can look at that. It'll tell you when it was last updated, but then you can also look in the developer view at the change log and see how many updates have been done. Maybe a plugin's been in there for a year and it's been updated 3 times, most recently 1 week ago. That could be an indicator of the level of, maybe not code quality, but support needed for the time by the developer.
Those are all excellent things to look for. On top of that, there's one other thing that I would add is to look at the support and see if the developer is responding. A lot of times there can be some really great plugins developed and released, but that developer doesn't have a support team or doesn't have the desire to communicate back. So you want to make sure that if you download this plugin and something does go wrong, you've got somebody standing behind it that can help out. That's not just for WordPress repository plugins. I also use that same frame of mind when I'm purchasing plugins from somewhere like Code Canyon. I check not just if they have a support forum, but in the comments section is a really great place. If you go to comments and you see potential purchasers leaving comments to ask about the plugin, if the author is responding in a reasonable time frame, that's a great sign. If you see comments that haven't been responded to for months or even a year, then to me that's a sure no-no. I don't want that lack of support.
And to piggyback on the support forum, you can also see kind of what are current issues with the plugin. So if there is a lot of people, you know, reporting or commenting on a thread of a current issue that they would impact you, maybe it's not the right time to try that plugin. Another option too is there's a website called the WordPress Vulnerability Database, and you can go there. I think it's wpvulndb.com. And you can put in the name of a plugin, and it will tell you if there are any open security issues for that plugin. So that kind of also gives you a little bit of a report of history on the plugin as well. You can see issues that have been reported there in the past. So that kind of gets you an idea about the responsiveness of the plugin author, and also, you know, is it secure? Because there could be an open security issue, and if so, probably not the right time to use that plugin.
So to follow up on something you just mentioned on security, what is the problem, or is there a problem, with leaving a deactivated plugin in your WordPress site, your WordPress dashboard? Doesn't it just sit there and just stay quiet?
I love this question. So on the face of it, having a deactivated plugin isn't doing anything to your site, right? It's not firing, it's not adding any features. However, if you think of it in terms of security and malicious people, they are looking for software. If they happen to get into your web server or a web server or an account of another site on the same server that you're on, all of these automated bots, and most of them are automated bots, are looking for software. They're not looking for a plugin that has been deactivated and say, oops, it's deactivated, I can't do anything with it. It's all code, right? So if you don't have a need for a plugin, or a theme for that matter, get rid of that software on your server. Because it's probably not likely, but it could be likely that there's a vulnerability in there. A year or so ago, RevSlider was a very popular carousel plugin, and it had a major security flaw. And so if I had RevSlider installed but deactivated, it still could have been taken advantage of.
Also, a lot of times plugin updates are there for a reason. A lot of times it's to help with security breaches. If you have a plugin on your site that's inactive, there's a very good chance that you're not updating it because you're not using it. So the old saying, if you don't use it, you lose it. In this case, you should, because if you're not keeping it up to date, you're just opening that possibility for vulnerable attacks for your site.
We have about 10 minutes left. Does anyone else in the audience have a question? Okay, could you stand up? First one with the microphone.
Can you tell us some of your favorite plugins?
I won't mention any of mine because that's just not right. You know, there's a baseline for kind of must-have plugins. SEO. What's the most popular SEO plugin in the repo? It's called WordPress SEO by Yoast. That is one of my favorites. Come back to me.
This is such a loaded question. There's so many. We could stay up here for another hour, I'm sure. One that I like to point out, because Gravity Forms is amazing. If you've got any form needs on your site, Gravity Forms will most likely cover that for you. However, I have had clients when I was freelancing that did not want to pay the Gravity Form license. And that's how I stumbled upon Caldera Forms. And I really have become a big fan of theirs. The usability is great. And the out-the-box plugin has so much that it can already do for you. Yeah, Yoast SEO is another good one. A security and a backup plugin. I use WordFence and Updraft for backing up. And I promise I'm not trying to put a plug for my company, but I use the Toolset Types plugin before I ever started working for the company. And that the reason I like that plugin is because it allows you to build anything on your site. It creates any kind of custom post types, custom fields, custom taxonomies, and you don't have to do any PHP coding. Remember I mentioned I'm not the coder up here. So if you're looking for a unique way to expand your site and turn it into something different, Types might be a good plugin for you.
I think every single one of our sites we build has this plugin on it. It's just called flat out redirection. So it's a 301 redirection tool. So it allows you to monitor the 404s that are coming into your site. And you could then, so if you know someone is coming into a page that is slash, you know, about dash us, and you don't have that page anymore because of your redesign, now it's just about, you can set a redirect for that page so it ceases the 404 and redirects users to the proper location. Redirection.
So just to follow up on that, the question of what are your favorite plugins is kind of a relative arbitrary. Like we said, we could sit up here for probably 5 hours and talk about all of our favorites, but I would urge you to ask yourself the question, what are the baseline needs of any website, right? So there's SEO, there's security, there's opt-in forms, there's maybe a photo gallery. So identify those individual needs first and then start searching the repository for the most popular ones in those specific categories. But just to add, it's not always the most popular ones that will give you the functionality you need or are the best ones for your use case. Quick example, when we created Foo Gallery, NextGen Gallery had 1 million+ installs and there was probably 3 dozen other gallery plugins, but we identified a little need and we made rooms for ourselves.
I had seen it in another person. Okay, can you stand up?
As far as plugin updates, what is best practice for doing those updates? Do you do them immediately or wait 24 hours so people can discover if there are any bugs and you won't fall into those? Or, I usually wait 24 hours, but here's what your best practices are.
I think as long as you have a staging environment, there's no need to wait. I used to be under that same mindset where I was like, let me let everybody else update and see if anything goes wrong, and then I'll wait it out a little bit. But now that I've got everything set up on the staging environments, I pretty much do the updates right away. I'll update WordPress core first if there's an update for that, because I've done it where I've updated my plugins and then update core, and then there's more updates for my plugins. But really, I don't find a need to wait. But that's just my opinion.
I would take a look at what's going on in the update of the plugin a little bit. So if it's a security release and that's all they're talking about in the change log, so like when you see your update notification, it was like, oh, this is what's changed in this release, or here are release notes for it, see what they're talking about. If they're saying things like fixes a security vulnerability, XYZ, fixes it, and that's all they're talking about, don't hesitate, click that update button. But if you're looking at something that is a major release, and I'll use WooCommerce as an example. When they went from went into version 3.0, that was a major release. that had a lot of changes going on, and it broke a lot of sites. So waiting in that situation or using a staging environment is the good approach. And I'd also add, if you have a whole list, like you were mentioning, updating core first and et cetera, do all those things at one time. Like WordPress is great and gives us the ability to say, you know, show me all plugins that have been available, update, check all, update all, then your site breaks and you don't know where it happened. So take a one-by-one approach, you know, update core, check your site, update plugin one that has an update, check your site, and go on through the list. It's tedious, but if you go through that whole process and nothing happens, you feel good. If you go through that process and the second plugin breaks, you can at least stop there and you'll feel a lot better than when you have a mound of updates and you're just saying, I don't know where this went wrong.
We have about 2 minutes left. Whoever has the microphone before I let you ask your question. After the session, because we're going to probably run out of time, will you guys be available during the ice cream break? Excellent. So if you didn't get to ask your question, feel free to ping them later.
We could actually carry the conversation on Twitter, too, if you want to do that. Yeah, we could take questions via Twitter.
Okay. My name's Heather. The question I have is how you go about finding the plugins you want. I mean, I know there's a search feature, of course, but do you first start with, you hear from, you know, through the community of a name, and then you just look for the name of it, or do you actually search for what it is, the description, and how effective is that? They need better categories for plugin types.
It's multifaceted, right? You can do a search, you can use keywords, you'll see the ratings, and then it's about what we talked about before, looking at all the indicators that a plugin is the one that you actually want. You can also do a simple Google search too, but then definitely talk to other people in your WordPress community, whether it's in a group or something else, and ask them what their go-to is. I found so many cool solutions just by talking to other people that I wasn't aware of, so.
I typically will search on the repository first. If I don't see what I'm looking for there, then I'll do a generic Google search, just using the keywords of what I'm looking for. And then if I were to have results, maybe two that look very similar to one another, but one is by a very well-known company, then I would lean towards, you know, knowing, or the, going with the brand that I know. Adam mentioned asking your community. There's a lot of Facebook groups that are built around WordPress, and that's a really good community to post a question. You'll almost always get immediate answers, although you will get a lot of opinions on Facebook groups, too.
So let's give a round of applause to our panelists. So thank you for sharing your expertise, and thanks to all of you who have asked questions, and I hope you have a great remaining part of WordCamp. Have a good day.